Israel. She was 17, and she was traveling alone, and she was very upset and crying. And my mom said, my daughter, which is me, has a home. It's just her and her husband and her little girl. And like I said, my daughter Samantha was 9 at the time. She said, if you want, if you think you'd feel better, I'm sure she would love to have you come and stay. And so Libby spoke to her dad. Her dad, because her parents went to, she was on her way to New York. Her family went the day before because she was going to a bar mitzvah in New York of a family member. She had to stay and come on the next day because of some school exam that she was doing. School had just started over there in Israel. And so anyway, she said she called her dad. He said, yes, whatever, that'd be good. He called here, her dad did, spoke to me and spoke to my husband. Libby came and stayed with us. Libby was so sweet. She came, she had a shower. First I fed her. She had a shower, and we had a spare room. And of course, we knew the people were on the planes for like 24 hours, so there was time. Yeah. Everyone had their sheets, and it was beautiful weather. Everyone had their sheets done and out on the line, so like the spare room was all fresh sheets, fresh towels. She came, ate, she went to bed, and we didn't see her for 12 hours.
Poor thing.
She didn't get up for 12 hours. And when she came out, you know, she ate. It changed her being here, changed all of us. And she's just such a sweet, and her dad, when he phoned, and he spoke to me, and he spoke to my husband, Dean, and he just was like, thank you. And, you know, and where Samantha, my daughter, was 9 at the time, a little girl, there was lots of girl stuff here. So, you know, she felt comfortable in our home, and she felt safe. And, you know, that affected me and my family and everybody that helped during that time. Everybody was affected so deeply. And I really thought that the Come From Away, more than the other things that I had seen, they captured that. They captured how little stories, people that every one individual, and there's stories that I will never know them all about all the people that did things, go to, you know, get prescription drugs for people, go, you know, whatever it was, make vegetarian food for them, make kosher food for them, buy, you know, whatever, everything that could humanly be done, that was able to be done by the people here was done. I mean, I witnessed it. We were no exception. Everybody was doing that. And I really think the Come From Away, that's the thing that they really got. It involved here, Gambo, Glovertown, Lewisport, you know, Glenwood, Appleton. It was a community effort. And when I went to see it in New York, I wore a T-shirt that said, I've come from Gander. And because I was so proud of it. And when people in the audience recognized that T-shirt, people were like, oh, my God, you're from Gander. You were there. Were you there? What did you do? What did you see? How did it happen? And it was just an avalanche of emotion. And, you know, this is what Commander Gander experiences in this book. He goes, and it's that same. And, you know, the book ends with him in a pensive mood, sitting, looking at the window in the airplane on the way home. And he's thinking, I didn't do it for the thank yous. The people here in Gander and Glovertown and Glenwood and everywhere, Goose Bay and St. John's and everywhere else that it happened, we didn't do it for the thank yous. We did it because it was the right thing to do. And that's
there's no way anyone could have ever known that the gratitude would have moved into
ballooned.
Something so big. You know, I guess big little gestures, but big gratitude. And
exactly.
I noticed on your Twitter that Michael Rubinoff and Irene and Sankoff
yes.
and David Hine are all, you know, paying attention to this book. And that feeling that I had about Come From Away in the arena, I have that feeling about your book that you have coming.
Goodness, from your lips to God's ears, say, Carolyn.
Well, first of all, it already has the endorsement of the major people who, you know, need to provide
it. Well, they've read it.
Michael
David
Rubinoff.
And Irene have read it. They the text. They haven't seen it. Of course, the illustrations are not even all done yet. But the they haven't seen the completed product. But they absolutely loved the text. So that made me. I had to sit down. My knees got weak when I got that email. That, you know, that they, because an endorsement from them on any level was just, you know, I had to sit down. It made my knees feel a bit funny. I was like, oh, my God. The fact that they even know that my name is what, you know, and that I exist in the universe is mind-blowing. So, you know, I'm just thrilled. So whatever it works out is, I'm already thrilled, and it's not even out there yet.
Yeah, well, Irene Sankoff and David Hine just a few years ago were a couple of regular people trying to make it in the writing.
Well, you know, this is the thing, isn't
trying
it?
Trying to make it, and now they have made it beyond, you know, any level of success that you could think of. I mean, it's just such a big production, and you know, it has, I don't know, I have people who go to theater in New York a lot, and, you know, so they go see everything. And
right.
I had one friend who, you know, Come From Away was just another show that they, you know.
Sure.
And so then they saw the show and messaged me and said, why didn't you tell me? And I'm like, I did tell you. But why didn't you tell me it was so good? And I said, I did, but you just thought it was just me being a Newfoundlander.
Yeah. That's right.
But they were just absolutely blown away. They said, I just cannot believe how, you know, it was different. It was well done. It's energetic. It's sad. It's happy. It's you want to march on, you know, it gets you indignant, and then it gets you ticked off, and then it gets you ashamed a little bit. And, we've done that too. And but we did this as well. And it's just, and it's remarkably accurate.
That's what I liked about it, that it told the stories that, you know, of course it didn't tell all the stories, but it told enough of the individual stories that the germ of truth is so pure, and that's what I, you know.
I can totally see it playing out. Like, I remember the scene where they're at the bar and you know, there are two gay characters.
Yep.
And basically, you know, they come out that they're gay, or it comes out that they're gay. And the response of the locals in this, you know, because they're in this rural town where, and
exactly.
I watched that and went, I'm from even smaller town, and I could totally see it playing out that way. You know, it's, well, you know, that's it.
Yeah. That's right.
It's odd to me, but it's all right, I suppose. sort of thing, you know. People are people. Yeah. Have a beer. And
that's right.
That to me was like quintessential. Like, you just the expectation
very much
of what we are and what and what
of
we
what
are
we
is
are.
So different.
Yeah. I mean,
and
I'm such a proud Newfoundlander. Newfoundlanders are the best. It's like I've always said, if you're ever in a situation in life, you know, you get a flat tire and you're in you know, I don't know, downtown Toronto, you want a Newfoundlander to stop.
Yeah.
If you're ever in any place and you know, if you're lucky enough to have a Newfoundlander around and you need help, you're lucky, because that is, Newfoundlanders are the best. I've always thought that, and I will always think that forever.
I have a little story. We're over an hour here chatting, but I have a little story, and then we'll wind up so you can get back to regular life. But when we first moved here, we've been living here 6 years now. We've been back six. It feels like I've been back for way longer, but it's just 6 years. And my kids started school in January, because we moved in December. So I would say about 3 months in, like April, May or something, I thought, you know, I better talk to the kids, see how things are adjusting, new school, new province. So I said to Sophia, and she would have been how old was she? They were only little when we moved here. She's 15 now, so she was, you know, 10, 11. And I said to her, actually, she'd be 9. My math is, I'm a writer.
So, I hear you.
I said to her, I said, so, you know, what's it like, you know? And she, oh, it's good. And I said, so is there anything that stands out to you as being really different? And she thought about it for a minute. And she said, when I was in school, in our my old school, I really, really liked it. And she said,
right,
if I found wanted a pencil, I did, you know, I wanted to go to work and I didn't have a pencil.
Right.
And I put my hand up and asked if anybody had a pencil I could borrow. There would be surely one person who would give me a pencil.
Right.
And I'm thinking, okay, so where's this going? She's not giving me a pencil? And she said, here, she said, if I put up my hand and said I didn't have a pencil, could anyone loan me a pencil? Everybody would put up their hand.
Everybody. Yeah.
And I went, and I mean, I had given her no, you know what I mean? This wasn't a leading question.
No, I didn't say,
well, how are your flanders better than everybody?
Yep.
But I stopped and I went, you know, that is exactly what happens.
That's right.
And we can be like, it's a community thing.
It
when
is.
When the chips are down, we're a community. We all come together. And that's what I mean. All the labels go. It doesn't matter, you know, what your affiliate, what church you belong to. None of it. It's just we all come together.
Exactly.
We don't wait for that person to step up. Everybody steps up.
That's
and
right.
And I think that might come from being from small communities. Where we had to.
Yeah.
Right? Everybody had to step up and put that skiff out in the cove. And everybody had to, somebody's trap was tangled up and needed fixing. Everybody jumped in their boats and went and helped. They had to. Because
that's
the next time you needed their help. So you just
did it
for that reason, but also because my poor buddy got his, you know, you don't want anybody to have a hard time.
No.
And so all of that, and so all of that was, when she told that little story, I went, yeah.
Mm,
and I don't know
that
it's,
feeling.
I don't know that we're the only place that has that, but I know
no.
we have that.
We definitely have it, though. Yeah.
And so when come from away, when that situation happened and all the people needed help, everybody all over this region just,
yes,
we've got to do something. Every little bit helps.
Yes.
And so they have an idea that every little bit helps. They don't, I'm only doing this little thing, but if everybody does a little thing, it's a lot.
It's the cumulative effect of all of it. Yeah.
Yeah.
And on that note, too, before you go, I should tell you that a portion of the proceeds of the sale of all the books is going to the Janeway.
Wonderful.
Yes, because where this whole thing is about helping, you know, all of us felt from the very beginning, the very first time that the book was mentioned, there has to be a component of giving with this. It requires it. And where I'm a children's writer, I wanted it to be something that would benefit children. And so the Janeway was the obvious choice. Yep.
Well, that's wonderful. And it's it fits in nicely because this podcast is in, I work in partnership with Citadel House.
Oh, wow.
And Citadel House, Dean Stairs, they put the podcast together that you hear on Bridges Radio. And then I do the column for the paper. So
right.
it's all, sort of
right.
this... community effort there.
Exactly.
And Dean lost his son, Dean and Stevie, they own Citadel House. They lost their son 10 years ago to childhood cancer. It was 10 years in December.
Yes.
And so they do a charity called Gideon. That was their son's name, Gideon's Helping Hands. And every year they donate money from, they do open stages once a month for youth, 19 and under. So the kids come in, have the opportunity to perform, and it's a free will donation. You come in, you donate, put money in the hat, and enjoy the show. It's actually wonderful. Some of the performances, the show is as good as some of the professionals that come through. It's amazing.
Oh, wow,
what
it sounds great.
Here. And so, yeah, you should come out some night and check it out. It's
definitely
really fun.
Definitely.
And so the kids perform, and it's for a good cause. That money is gathered. And then in December, they have an auction, a silent auction and a show.
Right.
And they raise the rest of the money. So over the past number of years, since they've been doing this, they've raised over $7,000. And I think
fantastic.
This year was around $1,600. And they actually take it in and give it to families in need on the childhood oncology ward. In honor of
what
Gideon.
An important thing.
So
that so
fits nicely with what Citadel House does.
Yeah.
And we always like to support the Janeway in any way.
Because
the children.
Yeah.
I mean, you got to take
care of them. Absolutely. Yes.
So on